Good afternoon. What a great way to start 2016 with a new name, a new avenue, a new venue, an old friend. Well, he's not old, but our friendship is long. So it's really wonderful to have you all here. And as you know, my role as the CEO of the Gresham Area Chamber of Commerce is to thank profusely our sponsors. I'm Lynn Snodgrass, and I do appreciate the sponsorships that we have. I want to thank our presenting sponsors, Riverview Community Bank and Portland General Electric. Neither one are here today, unfortunately. They always come to the events. Larry from Riverview Bank had a death in the family and couldn't make it. And Portland General Electric is out campaigning for snow, so they have more work to do. No, I'm just teasing. John wasn't able to attend either. Our education sponsor is Gresham Barlow School District. Jim, thank you. Where are you? There you go. Thank you, Jim, very much for the sponsorship. We appreciate that. And our media sponsor, I'm going to read it exactly as it's printed. MetroEast Community Media. There we go. I always do it wrong. So thank you, Keith, for being here today. We appreciate that sponsorship. Everybody in here is an important person, but some people go to the extent of actually running for office to become an important person. So I want to recognize a couple of our elected officials. The mayor of Gresham, the best city in Oregon, Mayor Shane Bemis. Thank you, Mayor, for being here. And one of the council members from the city of Gresham, Kurt French. Can you stand, please? Hi, Kurt. Thanks for coming. Are there any other elected officials in the audience today that I haven't recognized? From anything? Your wife didn't elect you to be the best husband ever? You got to work on that. Okay. I would also like to recognize our chamber board members that are here today. The president of the chamber, who is a partner with Warren Allen LLP, Warner Allen. Warner, thank you for being here. This is an applause contest. We'll see who gets the most. Matt Miller of Gresham Sanitary Service. Matt, thank you. There we go. It was a good thing you brought your dad to clap for you today, Matt. Thank you for doing that. Corey Price of Gresham Grocery Outlet, and he is one of our newest board members. Corey, thanks for being here. Julie Reed, Legacy Mounted Medical Center. Julie, thank you. And also at that table is Athena Vadnis of Gresham Barlow. She is our very first ex officio board member, and we'll talk about that later. I'm going to introduce Brian Lessler in just a minute, who is the chair of the Government Affairs Committee. This is a luncheon that is run and managed by the Government Affairs Committee. However, several people came last year and said, "Ooh, I don't like politics. I didn't know that this wasn't about politics. This is really interesting. You should change the name." Well, I call that a wolf in sheep's clothing kind of thing, but that's exactly what we did. So we changed the name from Government Affairs Forum to Business and Leaders Luncheon. I wanted to call it Business and Leaders Talk so that I could say it was a BLT at lunchtime. That went over like a lead balloon in the office, as in the audience right now. So we are calling it the Business and Leaders Luncheon, but it is focused on things that are of a political nature and, you know, not necessarily just politics, but we need to know and need to have a connection with the decisions that are made and who are making those decisions. So we'll continue in the same mode, but we're going to fool a few people and bring them in. I also, obviously, the rest of you didn't get the memo, but Jack, who is a friend of mine, told me that anybody that brought a lottery ticket that didn't win anything, he would redeem them for the highest amount that was listed on here, whether it was a triple or not. So, Jack, I brought all of my lottery tickets for you to do that. These are the only ones that I bought.
Is there another person named Jack?
There we go. I just wanted you to know that I do participate. Okay, so there we go. It's a record, and my husband's going, "How come you didn't win? How much money are we spending on lottery?" Okay, there we go. I am now going to introduce the chairman of the Government Affairs Council and the owner of PDG Construction Services, Brian Lessler. Brian?
Thank you, Lynn. Thank you, Lynn. Does anybody know what the Powerball current jackpot amount is? 1.5 and growing. It's probably going to be bigger than that by tomorrow when they pick Shane's winning number. So the Mega Millions, which is the that's the Oregon version of that, is what, at 15 million now? And there are, I was looking online the other day because I've never bought a lottery ticket. I'm one of those guys. And there are about 20 different games you can play, maybe more than that, Jack will explain, in the Oregon lottery. I had no idea there were that many different games and that much money cycling through that system. So who has the winning ticket? Okay, you're my best friend now. And what are you going to do tomorrow? Are you going to show up at work tomorrow after you win?
Absolutely. I'd never stop my job.
There you go. Uh-huh. Okay, you lie and I'll swear to it, Warner. Any event, on the eve of this record-breaking lottery, it's just very timely and exciting to have Jack with us. Jack and his wife Tammy live in Eugene, as do their three adult sons, John, Joe, and Jake. Jack Roberts grew up in Eugene, where he graduated from Sheldon High School, the University of Oregon School of Journalism, and the University of Oregon Law School. And I found out that he was coming in just about the time I was leaving. So Jack is not old, because I'm not old. After 10 years as an attorney in private practice, Jack was first appointed and then twice elected to the Lane County Board of Commissioners. In 1994, he was elected State Labor Commissioner for Boley, as we're most familiar with, and he was reelected to that office in 1998. From 2003 into 2013, Jack was the executive director of the Lane Metro Partnership, a nonprofit economic development agency for Eugene, Springfield, and Lane County. In November of 2013, Jack was appointed director of the Oregon Lottery, a position he still holds today. In the past, Jack did not hesitate to submit written opinions regarding hotbed issues, whether business, tax, or environment. Many of his written opinions appeared in the Oregonian. Not only were his articles factual, they typically were laced with humor or a touch of sarcasm. First and foremost, Jack is a responsible, intelligent, and trustworthy statesman. It's my pleasure to introduce Mr. Jack Roberts. Please welcome him.
Boy, that was very nice. I was sort of looking around seeing who this guy was, because it's very, very, very nice and very generous. I also have to say that I'm here because Lynn asked me to be here. Lynn and I go way back. I came in as labor commissioner when she was coming in as a legislator, and we have known each other and been friends and colleagues and people who have worked together on a lot of things over the years, including I was co-chair of her campaign when she ran for Secretary of State, and she was co-chair of my campaign when I ran for governor. And we have not only a mutual admiration society, but we also belong to the wrong party to get elected to statewide office in Oregon. But that doesn't mean we're wrong. It means that Oregonians haven't learned yet. So that's why I hold today.
We also came in second.
Yeah, that's right. Good. That's a good point. We didn't lose. We came in second. If you came in second in the Powerball, you'd still be rich. But in fact, I'm going to tell you a little bit about it, because it's funny, because when she asked me to do this, I said, well, I'll come, but you know, I don't know that people are really that interested in the lottery. And back about a month and a half, 2 months ago, when she asked me, it wasn't such a big deal. And so once she hasn't lost her magic touch, she has, as mentioned before, in politics, she and I may be on the wrong side for Oregon, but she has a marketing sense that is second to none. And so she saw somehow premonition that lottery would be a good topic for today's meeting. And so I want to start with that, a little bit of the power. I was going to tell you a little bit more about the history of the lottery and how it happened, but I figured after a meal, you're already tempted to fall asleep, and I might put you to sleep if I gave you too much of that. But let me talk about Powerball and what's happened, because it seemed to suddenly come out of nowhere that we now have what is by far the largest lottery prize, not only in America, but around the world. This is a phenomenon, but it didn't happen by accident. You know, Powerball's been around for a long time, and it is true that there's another game, Mega Millions, and those used to be states, and they're both run by what's called the Multi-State Lottery, or MUSL is the acronym we use for it. And we've been members of that since we first adopted the lottery in 1984, and we were one of the states to help form that and start doing that. But they had this, and you had to do one or the other. You could either be a Powerball state or a Mega Millions state. And it turned out Oregon was a Powerball state. Washington and California were both Mega Millions states. So people would sometimes go across state lines to buy one or the other. But it was a competition, in effect. Then in 2010, they said, heck with that. We'll just let you have both. And so not everybody jumped to that. But we went to that eventually. But most people's loyalty here was still to Powerball. California, where the Mega Millions were big, Powerball's a little slower to catch on. But as it caught on, one of the things we found is that, not surprisingly, a whole lot more people are playing, which meant that more people were getting the winning numbers, and therefore the jackpots weren't rising as high. And Mega Millions, on the other hand, had a higher level. They were about 250 million to one. Powerball in those days was 170 million to one. Now that sounds like that's incredible, but when you look at all the numbers, a lot of people are buying multiple tickets with multiple numbers. So they were getting to the point where the Powerball wasn't getting to be as high. Mega Millions, about a year and a half ago, got to 600 million, which at that time was the highest we'd had in the United States, and one of the highest in the world. So the folks in Powerball said, we need to change the game a little bit now that we have so many players from these bigger states. And so they redid what's called the matrix of how you play and how many numbers you need to create a higher odds for getting the top jackpot, but creating more winners at lower levels. Because you get, they have 50,000 up to, you can get up to $1 million. In fact, we had a $1 million winner just last week from Gresham, guy who actually grew up in Portland, went to Jefferson High School, played on the football team with Mel Renfro and Terry Baker. So tells you he's been around a while. And he came in and won $1 million. And so I was talking to him and you know, congratulating him and wanting to know what his plans were. And his answer was, I just want to get rid of debt. I'm, you know, at this point in my life, I don't want to leave this behind for my kids or grandkids, whatever. I said, well, with a $1 million jackpot, you can probably do make a good dent into that debt you have. And he was thrilled. And those are the heartwarming stories. But those are just a part of it. That's the exception. Most people don't win. The state doesn't make the money it makes because the odds favor the winners and we favor the players. It's a fun way that people have of making money. And so Powerball, let's change it so we're gonna have more of those winners, and then we'll let the jackpot get higher. And at the time, there was a concern, and it's still a concern, frankly, as we're all celebrating right now, but once you get to $1 billion, will people bother to play when it's merely down there at 70 or 80 or $100 million? I mean, it's hard even to say that out loud. But the truth is, people don't start playing until it gets higher. It's psychology. It's not about, would any of us turn down $40 million, which is where Powerball starts? No, of course not. We'd love to win that. But when you tell us, buy a lottery ticket, your odds of getting that $1 million is 290 million to one, you'd say, well, maybe there's a better investment I can make. So it's the fun of it that gets people excited to get them to play. And so now, as we're celebrating this, and we'll see what happens, and my guess is that by tomorrow night, it'll probably be up to 1.8 million or 1.8 billion. It could actually get to 2 billion. Because the mania of people playing so much, all that fuels the jackpot. The way that works, by the way, is that Powerball costs $2. Mega Millions is only $1. You have to pay $2 for the Powerball. But half of that goes into the jackpot, and then the other half stays with the state, and we allocate 16% kind of for overhead, and the rest of it goes to pay for schools and for parks and watersheds and for economic development, the things that are constitutionally dedicated for lottery money. But the jackpot grows as people play. And that's why when they start, then they see what's happening. And in fact, it was this morning, it went from 1.4 to 1.5. By now, I think it's probably getting close to 1.6. They don't make these changes immediately. They kind of watch and see where they are. And so we'll know tomorrow what it's going to be. I'm guessing it's going to be probably 1.8. Then if somebody wins, it goes back to 40, which is still not a bad sum of money to win. But you will see playership will drop dramatically. And we had a sign last week for the first time, at least since we've added the line games and the video poker and the other types of video games, we had more money played on the traditional games, particularly but not exclusively Powerball, than we did on video lottery. Video lottery has been the big money maker for Oregon, as it's turned out that of our sales in a typical day, about 70% is video lottery, 30% are the other games, the traditional games that we play. And of that, the profit margin, ironically, is actually higher for the video lottery, because we pay huge prizes, but the turnover is so great that it has been a money machine for the state of Oregon. Now there are people who criticize that and say, can't those be addictive? And the answer is yes, for a small percentage of the population. There are people who do get addicted to those games. The state of Oregon dedicates 1% of all the net revenue, as the legislature does this, to help pay for treatment. So we have free treatment for gambling addicts. We put a lot of money into some of the ads you may see and try to talk to people. We now do training for our retailers to try to help deal with that. But at the end of the day, it's a major moneymaker for the state of Oregon. And the traditional games, more people play, but less frequency. So in trying to balance all these, and we look at what we're doing for the state, what we try to do is make sure that we are being responsible in how we advertise these. So you will not see ads that say, go out and play because you can win a whole lot of money. We say play for entertainment, play for fun, and yes, there are prizes, but the odds are you're not gonna win. We basically turn over to the legislature $1 billion a biennium from lottery. It is the second largest revenue source for the state general fund, second only to personal income tax. We actually make more money than the corporate income tax does for the state of Oregon. And again, we don't do that because the odds favor the player. And everybody should know, when you're buying this, odds are you're not going to win. But if you do win, it can be for a good chunk of money. It can be a lot of fun, a lot of excitement for you. In the meantime, when you play and you lose, you're helping to fund critical state services. In fact, I have a couple of the examples that I use to explain this to people is I say that the lottery is the second largest revenue source and the largest that's not collected at the point of a gun. Nobody goes to jail for not playing the lottery. You decide whether you want to play the lottery or not. Try that on your income tax. You know, I choose not to pay. So when you look at this, or sort of from a financial standpoint, it does sort of ring true that we're enticing people to do something that is economically a bad decision, unless you care about schools, you care about the economy, you care about protecting our parks and our watersheds and the salmon restoration, which has helped keep us from having the salmon listed as endangered species, which has a lot of other implications for controls over our resource use and our economy and other things. All those things are things that the voters have voted on. And at the end of the day, and it's going back a long time in my life, I've been filing tax returns and I've never won. Every time, they get the money, I don't. So from the lottery at that standpoint, I don't apologize to people for running a lottery, even though I had to admit that I've never played the lottery. I'm just not one of those people who gets excited about playing. Of course, now I can't. At $1.5 billion, I might change that if I could, but I can't. So, and neither can my immediate family, at least under their own names. Now, I'm not sure. When it gets to $1.5 billion, I don't know. They may disinherit me. Thinking that, but nonetheless, this isn't about, you know, we don't try to coerce people into playing. We're trying to advertise the availability of lottery, and we have some clever ads and some things that we do, and sometimes some of the ads we have some kind of quirky people on them, and I get complaints. And fortunately, as was pointed out earlier, I have a degree in journalism, so I learned a little bit of something about the marketing and advertising business. And I'm thrilled when people complain to me about our ads, because it means they noticed them, they knew the product, and it made an impression on them. And they're not going to decide to buy or not to buy because they didn't like some quirky guy on there carrying on. It's noticed. I don't know how many of you folks here are old enough to remember years ago that people used to win all the awards for advertising. It was Alka-Seltzer. They did the ads, no matter what shape your stomach is in, I can't believe I ate the whole thing, all that stuff. They were constantly winning awards. It was so clever, so original. And then finally they fired their advertising agency. So what happened? What was wrong? So we did a survey, and we found that everybody loved the ads. Everybody could recite the ads, except none of them knew what we were advertising. They didn't recognize the product. So they went back to plop, plop, fizz, fizz, because everybody knew what that was. They not only knew that, because people said, well, isn't it Alka-Seltzer? Yeah, it's something, but I don't know, what is Alka-Seltzer? Is that like a seltzer model? Is it, what is it? They didn't know the product. And so that is the key to advertising, is it's not to entertain people, it's to get them to understand and recognize your product and to play. And that's what we try to do with the Oregon Lottery. And we advertise it as entertainment only. We advertise it as fun. I saw an ad from a lottery across the country, and it was generally not too bad, but the part that struck me was somebody won a jackpot. Oh, isn't this great? Now we can afford to send our kids to college. I said, that's the wrong message. I mean, we all want to send our kids to college. Don't play the lottery expecting that's going to pay for it. Put your money in savings, put in an investment, have that taken care of, and then if you have money left over, then go play the lottery rather than go bowling or play golf or whatever else you want to do. That's your form of entertainment. That's your decision. But that's money. It's not your core needs. It's not your core values. You're not trying to solve your problems in life. And as I, you know, mentioned, the guy earlier said, great, this will help me get out of debt. I don't think he was counting on the lottery to help him get out of debt. A lot of people today struggle in today's economy to get into debt. And if you can win the lottery and it helps you, then God bless you, that's great. But that's not your business plan. That's not your economic plan. That's not Oregon's economic plan. Our plan is to try to grow our economy, do a lot of positive things, and if people like to play the lottery, then let's have it in a regulated, fair, an honest game. We had gambling long before we had lottery. In fact, that's what's interesting when we look at things about problem gambling. And we're doing a study, we're hoping to fund a study. It's being done independently by the Oregon Council on Problem Gambling. It shows that there are anywhere from 1 to 3% of the population who have a serious gambling addiction problem, and another 2 or 3 who maybe have a problem with gambling more than they should. What's interesting is that's been true for 40 or 50 years, long before we had legalized gambling in the country. We've always had gambling. We've always had gambling in Oregon. And we've tried to get it under control. We're trying to make it work for us, and we're trying to make it a responsible part of a broad funding source for the state. And I'm one of those who believes that there are things that are worth paying for. That's the thing a lot of times people say, oh, you're always complain about the government, and I do complain a lot, but in the end of the day, we need to have a government, we need it to be responsive, we need it to be responsible, and we need to pay for it. And if this is one piece of how we're paying for it, we want to be managed the best it can be, and we'll try to make it as successful as we can. And that's what we see our job at the lottery. And we're fortunate to have a lot of good people who work there and who work very hard to maintain its integrity, make sure it's fairness, but also try to make it fun. So that's kind of what we're doing now. And rather than go on at greater length, I'd like to hear from you. Not only, I mean, if you have questions, I'm glad to answer them, try to answer them, but also any input you have to me about whether it's the lottery or sort of the whole sort of funding system we have here. I'd like to hear from you what you think as citizens about what we're doing and what role lottery is playing and should play, and what are the things that you think we ought to do more of. So with that, let me turn to you and invite your questions. Yes, ma'am.
There's a microphone, oh. So we're going to pass that around so that it can be recorded.
Where does the kicker go? You were talking about the $2 for Powerball, but then if you do the kicker, that applies to the multiplier.
Yeah.
So where does the kicker go?
It's basically treated the same way. It's sort of split half for the jackpots, and then half is divided among our overhead and then revenue. So the money basically is the same, but that helps to fund the enhanced prizes. Yeah. No, that's a good point. That is a good point.
So we've all read the stories about people embezzling from the Little League or the PTA or whatever it is, and invariably the story says that the money went into video poker. Is there any program at the lottery to help to reimburse some of these, particularly the smaller nonprofits who have been embezzled as a result of somebody's gambling addiction?
No, the answer to that is we don't, and I don't believe the state of Oregon generally reimburses for people who are victims of criminal behavior. And I do, there are, you do hear certainly a lot of those stories, but I wouldn't say it's invariably that's what happens, but certainly there are people who get in trouble through gambling. They get in trouble also through alcohol and drugs and other problems that they have. And we don't, now the state of Oregon could decide that if they wanted to fund that out of the $1 billion of biennium we get, if they want to carve out part of that, they'd have to go change the Constitution, because right now all of those uses that we have today are constitutionally mandated. But if they chose to do that and wanted to use that as a way to reimburse for that, they could, but we don't do that.
Thank you, Director Roberts, for being here today. Appreciate it. Couple questions on, I know a couple years ago there was a push through the legislature about limiting the amount of gaming devices in particular areas, I think Hibbs, Hayden Island. I'm wondering, is that something that you're still looking at, and is there any sort of analysis that determines the community impact that happens when high concentrations of machines or delis or gaming centers go in? We're watching it happen in different parts of this city, and they present a different, you know, they present not only a social issue, but they also have real-world law enforcement impacts, you know, that aren't necessarily transferred from the state down to the local community to deal with. And so I know that this would, you know, in terms of regulating the amount of machines per capita that can go into a community or something like that, have you done any analysis on that or thought about that at all?
There has been. We have adopted a rule, what we call our concentration rule, specifically as a result of Hayden Island, but it applies everywhere. And it really deals with, because the situation at Hayden Island is you had, it's like a strip mall that filled up with video lottery retailers. I think they had 12 there at one time. And what the rule that we passed said is that we're not going to allow more, and it depends a lot on how many storefronts there are, but the maximum anybody could have is 6. And if it's smaller, then it's about half of the place to have those. And that's been implemented, that's being followed. Because Hayden Island had more, they had some time to ratchet that down. We've got it down to 8 now. There were 2 more left, and we are moving to terminate their contract. And we're actually involved in litigation with that now. That situation is also a little different in that the retailers have voluntarily paid for some law enforcement security efforts, and they're doing some other things, so they may ultimately come to some kind of terms with the local community to try to figure out a way to manage that. But it's the first step we have really taken to try to address what you're talking about. I think we're open to ways to go farther, and it doesn't have to always be in rule and a strict mathematical rule. If we have communities, if you have some here, you see we have some concerns about these areas. This is one of the things that in the past, I think to some extent, we've dealt with this as if
you were applying for an OLCC license, which is different than, we have a contract. OLCC is giving you a license to sell liquor. We actually have a contract to operate our business in your establishment. So we don't have to go anywhere that we don't believe is in the good business of the community. So having that dialogue and talk about that and make sure we don't over saturate an area or expand is something we're very interested in doing and working with.
One difference between OLCC is that locals actually have the opportunity to weigh in when somebody applies for an OLCC
right.
license. So that dialogue is
no, you're right.
That may be a good model to think about as we move forward.
Yeah, I think that is a good point. And you know, the other side of that is that there's a sort of legal entitlement to have that if you qualify, whereas in our case there isn't really that same right. And so we could have more flexibility, but that doesn't do any good if we're not giving you a chance for input. So I think that's something we need to look at.
This has nothing to do with any of the things you threw out, but I was wondering, wasn't there a person from Iran that won the lottery, and what has happened on that?
It's actually Iraq.
Iraq, okay.
And I know it starts to keep them straight, but it was a gentleman from Iraq who showed up as a winner. It was Oregon's game, which is Megabucks, which is only sold in Oregon, has a much smaller jackpot, but a much better chance of winning. Your odds there are only 9 million to 1 against you. So, I mean, that's almost a sure thing, right? So this guy won. He won our jackpot, $6.4 million. And he just suddenly showed up here. And we knew he had won. It was several months earlier. We didn't realize he was trying to figure out a way to get his travel visa to come to the United States and get it. So he came in, and we were, to say the least, a little perplexed about that. And the first thing we did was, of course, we did an extensive background check on him. We checked with the Terrorism Task Force. We checked with the Interpol, which is the international police. We did all those things to find out. And everything checked out. He seemed to be legitimate. And I met with him and talked to him. And it turns out that he bought his ticket on a website, which it apparently, the best we can figure out is it sort of seems to be staffed in London, but it's incorporated, the corporation is incorporated in Belize, and all this stuff looked really flaky. But apparently what their practice is they get local people who actually physically buy the tickets and hold them, but they buy them with the numbers that are submitted by somebody online, and so people in other countries can tech, because in Oregon, you have to be in Oregon to buy Oregon Megabucks or anything from the Oregon Lottery. We can't sell it across state lines. But if you're here, it doesn't matter whether you're an Oregon resident or even a United States citizen. If you can come and you can pay your money, you can get a ticket. So this looks like it's kind of a loophole in what our process has been, although so far we haven't really seen how that by itself is violating our rules and policies. We do know that they mark up the price and sell it for a lot more than we do. But again, if somebody pays that, we haven't found that that's really a violation of, and we had both the State Department of Justice and the U.S. Attorney's Office looking at, can you see any reason, can we held this for a week before we paid him? And they said, we can't really find anything, any law that's been broken. The other thing about this guy that to me made it a little different is that while he's from Iraq, he is a Kurd. And the Kurds are a minority group in that area that have been sort of oppressed by everybody. The Turks don't want them. Iraq has, Saddam Hussein, I mean, we always heard this story about Saddam Hussein's a terrible guy. He gassed his own people. Those were the people he gassed, were the Kurds. And he's living in Baghdad. He's apparently a prominent business person. That's one of the reasons why I made the decision not to reveal his name, because I saw the name. We have his name. We ran it through the police. We did all that. But name means nothing to me. But he said, in my country it does. And apparently it had a sister. It had been kidnapped once before and held for ransom. That's what goes on in that part of the world. So I couldn't see any advantage to giving people this name when it doesn't mean anything here, but it could put. And he has a wife and two young kids. And so I said, we're not going to do that. And the other thing that reassured me about the guy is that he had the option to take the cash payment, which for our game, we only pay 50% for cash and
you know, as I said, the Powerball looks like it was 70%, but we have the cost and expense of doing that. Plus, about half the people still take the cash, so it works out for us. But he didn't do that. He said he'd take it over, and ours was 25 years, not 30 years at that time. So I said, okay, well, this guy, it doesn't sound like he's trying to finance terrorism or do that on the 25-year plan. although the rate we're going, they're probably still going to be doing this stuff 25 years from now. But still, all those things added up. So we said, yeah, we're going to do it. Now, then we looked back at the retailer and said, well, so did he know or what did they know? And we're still looking into some of that. But it does appear to be something of a loophole in our laws that someone can buy. Now, you can't sell them over the internet. And so if they physically transferred it and done that, that might have been a federal law. Now, whether they would have enforced it, you know, they have to make decisions as to where their resources can be used. We don't know. But it does appear like they found a way to make that happen. Now, is that going to happen with the Powerball? Maybe, and in which case, that will get huge attention. And this one, our story got, it was in the New York Times and in the Seattle Times and other papers. But most people after looking at it said, no, it really didn't look like a big deal. So it was an interesting fact. It's one of those things. It's one of the things I like about the lottery is that when I get up and go to work in the morning, I never quite know what I'm going to run into. But it was, in my mind, it was a legitimate winner, and there's no harm. And as actually even some of the editorials for once got it right, and they said, so if this means if people are buying our tickets overseas, that means more money's coming into Oregon and we're using, where's the beef? And we still withhold taxes. We held Oregon and federal taxes from his payments, and we'll continue to do that for another 24 years.
Thank you. Hmm. Hi, so can you explain the steps that are involved in claiming your lottery winnings and then how those winnings are taxed?
I'll do the best I can, although as I said, I've never won one. But what I understand how it works, and you know, we have people who do that. But basically, if you win, you show up with your ticket. We encourage people, if you have a winning ticket, to sign the back. Because if it otherwise gets lost or stolen, a ticket is what we call a bearer instrument. So whoever has it gets paid. And so, in fact, talking about the Iraqi guy, if he had just said, hi, I'm from Iraq, I bought this, or he didn't even say he was from Iraq, just said, hi, I bought this, this is where it is, we'd take down the information about him. But we don't inquire a lot. If you have the ticket, we figure you're entitled to be paid. Then they will ask for some information. You have to give Social Security number, and you have to give your name and address and other things. A lot of that can be kept confidential if you can show there is some risk of threat to your life. Normally, the only thing we normally don't is name. In the case of this Iraqi man, I sort of made an exception and hasn't been tested yet in court. So I was very pleased in that case. The media did not push. We told them we wouldn't give them the name. They said, well, we think you have to. And we said, well, look, this is the story. And, you know, I'll be biased here, in a rare act of sort of, I'll just say, I'm going to get myself in trouble. I know. Those guys on the TV have left, haven't they? But in a rare act of civility, the media said, we're not going to push for getting the name, we're not going to do that. But normally, you have to give your name, you have the personal information. They'll probably ask you some other questions, which you can or don't necessarily have to answer about, well, where did you win this, what did you do? But we actually already, in some cases, will have some of that information about where it's been purchased and all that. And then at that point, depending on what you won, you'll be given a choice as to you want to get it all in cash or get it over time. Now, if you win $5,000, you're going to take the cash. But if you win hundreds of thousands of dollars, you might want to get paid out over time. If you win millions of dollars, then you really should think about that because it is a good, secure investment. But all that aside, that's basically what you do to get paid. Now, in terms of what they do in terms of checking that information, they will also first check to see whether you owe past due child support. And that's for years has been there that they take that first. They've just added this year, if you have been overpaid for certain assistance business, food stamps, other types of public assistance, that now has been passed as something that they'll take that first. So some people will do that. But Otherwise, then you'll get your payment. The other thing that's a little tricky about this is that we pay by check, and there's some people who don't have checking accounts. And so we've been trying to work with we'd love to get to a debit card system and let people get it that way, but we're running into some problems with the Department of Treasury and how that will work or what would happen with it. But that's sort of how it is. Now, Cameron, was there more to your question that I may have forgotten?
Taxes.
Oh, about the taxes? Oh, the taxes, the withholding taxes, the standard withholding. First of all, it will depend. If you can give them information about your income and that, they can try to estimate what your federal is and what the state. But it's basically 8% for state, even though the state does have some higher brackets than that. It basically uses 8%. For the federal, again, it depends kind of on where you are in your income bracket. And there's also, you can, you know, deduct the state against the federal. So the maximum it would be, like the person, if you win the $1 billion, the federal withholding will be about 39.6%. But it's lower than that for, you know, kind of what the amount is and what your tax situation is. But then we have to withhold that. And then when you file your return, you include both what you won and what the withholding was. And so you can, there may be some adjustment based on that. But it's treated as ordinary income and is taxable in the year that you receive it. So if you take the multi-year payout, then you pay taxes each year as it came through.
Do you have any demographics? Has anyone ever done a demographics on who is buying the tickets, typically? Income, age, that kind of thing?
We do. We actually do surveys every year on those factors and looking at it. And by and large, the playing demographics mirrors the public at large in most respects. It is a little bit. Well, first of all, you can't play if you're under 18 for the traditional, or 21 for the video. But even then, people in their 20s tend not to play. They don't have the excess money, and in many cases have other things they'd like to spend their entertainment recreational dollars for. So it skews a little older, but then when you get into the 30s, 40s, and 50s, and into the 60s and 70s, it pretty much mirrors the population. In terms of income, although there is an increasing number of people who say they don't answer that question, and we're not sure quite what that means, but otherwise, and going back 20 years ago, only about 7 or 8% of the people said they didn't want to answer. Now it's about 30%. So but it doesn't change much in terms of what the composition of it is, which is it does typically follow closely along the distribution of income in the population at large. There are more people who report less than $10,000 of income who play than there seem to be in the population at large. But part of the problem with that number is, does that include people who, if you're, because we don't ask them for any backup data, we just take their word for it. So if it's a husband and wife and only one of them works and the other one plays lottery, they say, well, I have zero income, or people who are kids, and by kids, I mean they're over 21 or over 18, but people in school don't have a lot of reportable income, but have other resources and assets, and they play. It's also true that a lot of those are people who may not have what we think of as taxable income, but who have other resources and assets. So that seems to skew that a little bit. Beyond that, then the very rich are less likely to play, I guess, because they don't need to. But within the other realms, it's pretty representative. There is the allegations often made that it mostly preys on the poor, and we're trying to be sensitive to that. But back when we had a higher level of response rate, it did not seem that there were large disproportionate number that were poor. As I say, to me, if someone makes less than $10,000, they have no business playing this at all. But they probably, in my mind, have no business spending their money on a lot of things they spend their money on, and we don't have any control over that. But it does not, we don't have any evidence that really suggests that this is primarily poor people trying to get rich. It's really mostly middle income people who are doing this for their form of entertainment. In terms of the demographics, Oregon is not a terribly diverse state. We do find that there's a large level of play among Hispanics. We don't have a large
black population. Asians typically have been below average in representation, but there are some indications that they're getting more play among the Asian community as a lot of their own personal demographics are changing. So we do watch that, and we try to see it for two reasons. One, we're concerned about our commitments to responsible gambling, and we want to make sure that vulnerable people are not being unfairly and unduly burdened by this. But of course, we also want to know who our customer base is. We want to know who's playing. We want to know why. And so we try to work through that and figure out how best to appeal to a broad cross section.
How often do you run into disputed claims of ownership, and how do you handle that?
Well, we do run into that from time to time. Sometimes it gets pretty nasty. Basically, our position is that the person, unless someone has signed it, if someone signed it, then only the person who signed it can cash it in. But most people still don't do that. So they'll come in with a claim, and they'll say, I want to cash this. We then don't inquire as to, are you the one who bought it or you did that? We will occasionally get someone call in and say, I just won, and somebody grabbed my ticket, and they run down to do that.
That's my story.
Yeah, that's right. And so, fortunately, our security arm is actually a part of the state police. We use the state police as our security, and they're there to help us. And their position is if there's good evidence that someone has, in fact, stolen it, then we're still going to pay them, but they can then arrest them. Now, I've heard that story ever since I've been there. It's never once happened since I've been there. What they do is they have the information. That's a dispute between the parties that are claiming it. That's why we stress to everybody, this is a bearer instrument. If you've got, it's like if somebody calls the store and says, hey, somebody stole my $20. If somebody comes in and tries to cash $20, don't pay. You know, say, no, we're not going to check that out. But we do try to impress upon people. And interestingly enough, when we have people from the state police who are asking them questions going into that, a lot of people will, if not entirely come clean, at least get nervous enough that there'll be some problems in their story that we can look into it. Now, that rarely happens. We do hear disputed claims about whose ticket it is and where it is, but what we try to stress to everybody is that it's your responsibility to keep your ticket, and if you want to protect that from someone else cashing in, sign your name on the back. And then there's a line there for it, and you can do that. And so, and then when we will, if we see that, we'll ask for ID, and we'll see that. So it's one of those things that does come up from time to time, but it does not appear to be a major problem for most players.
Jack, question from the head table
here. From on high.
You mentioned earlier that this is the second largest revenue source for the state of Oregon. I don't recall if you mentioned what the actual dollar amount of revenue from the lottery is that is created. And kind of a follow-up to that is, initially, many years ago when this started, the intent was that the dollars were going to be spent on education and economic development, as I recall. What percentage or amount of dollars that are raised through the lottery and the various games actually go into the state educational programs?
First of all, the amount of the net revenue to the state, the amount that gets transferred to the state, is something just in excess of $1 billion a biennium for the 2-year period. So it's $500 million a year. Of that, almost 60%, it's like 58-59% of it, goes to education. Now, that gets broken up into different pieces of education, and that's the legislature's call. There's no amount. I think initially there was some amount that was dedicated to certain types of education stability fund, and that some of that money may still be there, but that's purely statutory. They can change it if they want to, and how they deal with it. So they make that decision. Then of the remaining 60%, it's about 25%. Because there's 60%, 25% goes to economic development, but a lot of that is paying for lottery-backed bonds for construction, and that's used very broadly. In fact, years ago, Lynn may remember this, although it may have been before she got there, but it was kind of the laughingstock of the state when they decided, when it was only dedicated to economic development, they decided that prison construction was economic development because it put people to work to do that. And we, at that point, said, "Well, if that's economic development, then everything's economic development." But we also have, we're proud to say that we have the the highest rated lottery-backed bonds in the country, slightly better than Florida or West Virginia, which are other big lottery states and bonding states. But we have a very good record for that. We have 4-to-1 debt coverage, where you have $4 of income for every dollar that we allow the state to put out in bonds. And so that's where a lot of that comes from. And then there's 15% constitutionally dedicated, half to parks and the beaches, and half to the watershed and salmon habitat restoration. And so that, if you work that out on $1 billion, that's kind of where the money goes for those things. And there's 1% dedicated, that's statutorily dedicated to funding treatment for problem gamblers. A minimum of at least 1%. They generally just do the minimum. And from time to time, and Lynn will remember these days, when the budget gets tough, they say, notwithstanding that provision, we're only going to give so much. But that's their deal. It's, you know, when you make the rules, you get a chance to break them. So.
Okay, my question is, if you take the payout that's 25 years, and you don't live 25 years, what happens with the balance?
It passes to the heirs that you've designated or is in your estate. You get the full 25 years whether you live that long or not. Well, we give you an incentive to, though, if you you might take better care of yourself if you did that. But and she didn't even have a lottery pot to worry about. But it is true that the money is still there; it's still protected. Now, if you keep it in your estate and you die and your kids have, then there's some, it could be a state tax consequence if it's a really big one. I mean, that's one of the things that we always urge people, if they have a major win, get a financial advisor, go through this. If you have an accountant or a lawyer or someone, look at this and make your decision, because once you've made it, then you've made it. But until you do, you have a chance to figure, and a lot of people will split them up among family members and do other things with it, which you can do until you submit it to us, and then we pay it out. Whatever you select, that works.
Okay, we have time for two more questions.
Corey? I'm just kind of curious, just with this Powerball happening, what's the potential income for the state just on the ticket sales for tomorrow's drawing?
Well, of course, the sale of the tickets itself doesn't generate any money, because we get it, as we're part of the government, we don't pay taxes. But if somebody wins, if somebody gets the, let's say it's a single winner, which it probably won't be, just given the number of people playing, but if it's a single winner, gets $1.5 billion, and if they take the annual, and I'm not sure what that works out to be, but whatever that is, that will be taxed to the state of Oregon. It really, for most of those people, will be in a 10% bracket, because we have those higher brackets for the high income, and at that level you'll have a higher income. And then of course the federal government gets their share, but then the rest of the money, if the person stays here and invests it, then it's hard to, you know, guess what the additional effects are. It's sort of like somebody, if suddenly you had, let's say someone takes the cash payout and it ends up being about, as it could be, depending on where the jackpot is, could be $1 billion for the cash amount. $1 billion in this economy, and where, how it's spent, what happens to it, I mean, it could be huge for us. But just from the tax standpoint, getting the win here would be substantial in terms of additional. In fact, there's issue that Lynn mentioned earlier that could cause the kicker to kick, which, if that happened, which means a certain amount of taxes that have already been paid get refunded. In effect, everybody in Oregon would win the lottery to some extent if we won that here, that it would reduce everyone's taxes by a little bit. And one thing you can say for sure is that the governor, the legislatures will be crying about that, and the people who get the taxes relieved will probably feel pretty good about that.
Any other questions? Betty, just a minute.
I'm just curious, how much does the person that, the business that sells the winning ticket, how much do they get?
For winning, I mean, in addition to they get a commission on every ticket they sell anyway, and it depends on how much their volume is, what they get. But then if you have a winner, we have a winner's bonus, and it's basically 1% up to a maximum of $100,000. So for example, the
person who sold the ticket in Bend, who sold the ticket to the Iraqi who won the $6.4 million, then he got $64,000 for the winning, and he was pretty excited about that. If it's now the Powerball and someone wins that, that would capped out at the $100,000, but still not a bad bonus, particularly since they had nothing to do with them winning it. It's just sheer luck. But it's part of what we try to do to incentivize people to sell tickets and be good retailers.
Thank you. So did you enjoy this morning?
Yes.
I learned some new things. Did you learn some new things? Are you all going to rush out and buy a ticket? It looks like we need to support our own economy and buy lottery tickets instead of that Powerball stuff, but I'm not sure. I want to do something really special and introduce my husband, who dressed up to come today. So thanks, Drake, for being here. He's over here. Thanks for coming. You don't need to applaud. I cook him dinner every night. Okay, we have a couple of things that I do every single night, don't I? I do. Okay, we have a couple of announcements that are government affair announcements that I need to let you know. First of all, Thursday, day after tomorrow, will be our only opportunity as a business community to testify on the minimum wage legislation that's going to come. And the hearing is, you need to be in Salem at 5:00. It's our only opportunity. They're only going to take testimony once. We need to flood the room so that the business is represented on that issue. I can give you more information if you'd like after the meeting. And just 2 weeks away, our Business Excellent Award luncheon. It's going to happen at Greater Gresham Baptist Church. It's a wonderful event. We've started to slip out some of the names of who the winners are. You need to be there to see the whole gambit. It's going to be a wonderful lunch. I can't wait to do it. I want to thank our Riverview Community Bank sponsor, as well as Portland General Electric, Gresham Barlow School District, and MetroEast Community Media. I don't know why I have trouble saying that, but I always do. Thank you so much for our sponsors. In fact, would you give them a round of applause? Yes. Brian Lessler, PDG, who is the chairman of the Government Affairs, is building and has built and remodeled an incredible facility on Troutdale and Stark, and he had no idea that Kane Road would give him so much publicity and so much visibility at that. But you should drive by if you haven't already to see what a beautiful job he did on that. And I want to take just a second to let you know, Mayor didn't pay me to do this, nor did Kirk, but Lake Kane Road will be open in a couple of weeks. Maybe less time than that, so it'll be open again. And it was done entirely with local people helping and doing that work. So we thank you very much for shopping local and keeping it here. Thank you so for doing that. Okay, on your table is an evaluation sheet. It'll only take you a minute to do. And for everyone that we get back, we'll buy you a lottery ticket. And if your evaluation is picked, we'll call you a winner. I'm just kidding. Just like I'm going to give away a Hawaiian trip someday, too. Don't eat the money. Brian, thank you for this. Jack Roberts, it's wonderful to see you again. One more round of applause for Jack. And thank you all for coming today. Thank you so much.